That gave you a few ideas on the exposure of gambling, and now I'm going to have Roger Olsen come up. Roger is a certified problem gambling counselor. He has a degree in counseling. He's also a pastor, a minister, so he does a little bit of everything. And Roger works with us as our resource development. His job is to get clinicians trained across the state of Alabama to be able to help people with compulsive gambling problems. So, with further ado, Roger, come forward.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real honor and privilege for me to be here today. My name is Roger Olsen. I am a recovering compulsive gambler by the grace of God. Rooms like this, people like yourselves, I haven't gambled since March 4th, 1995. So if you do the math, that means tomorrow I'll have 20 years of sobriety, all one day at a time. Thank you. And I'm no stranger to the Kiwanis Club. Here's a picture of me when I still looked like my x-ray. In 1988, speaking in my hometown of San Diego, California, it's a good friend of mine, Frank Cole, he's sitting there from high school, and I was involved in Key Club all 4 years of high school, and when I got into Kiwanis, I was also the Key Club advisor for a number of years. So I commend all of you on the good work that you do, and thank you again for allowing me to be here today. This is Problem Gambling Awareness Month. The theme this year for our awareness is have the conversation. And that's what we're doing today. Governor Robert Bentley just issued a proclamation proclaiming Problem Gambling Awareness Month in the state of Alabama. Because it's a problem. Gambling disorder, which is how it's referred to in the Diagnostic Statistics Manual number 5, gambling disorder knows no border. Problem gambling can affect anyone, anytime, and anywhere. So why talk about problem gambling? Because it affects every person here. And if all of you, for just a moment, would just be brutally honest with yourselves, you would say, I know somebody within my family, within my circle of friends, within the people that work for me at my occupation, within the people I go to church with, I know somebody that doesn't know when to say when. The number one question that I get asked by the family of clients when they come to see me is, why can't they just stop? Why can't they just stop? And my comment to that is, it's an addiction. For me, I gambled for 3 years, from 1990 to 1993, and I woke up one day and I was bankrupt in all areas of my life. I lost the church that I was pastoring in Southern California, lost our house, our car, all because I couldn't say no. Just one more bet, just one more chance. People looked at me and they said, how can a pastor do something like that? And it's because it's an addiction and it can affect anyone at any time. There's something wrong with the on and off switch in a problem gambler. They just don't know how to turn it off. And it all takes place up here in the computer, in the front lobe of the brain. And problem gambling is a huge problem for Alabama stakeholders. Like Jack just said to you a minute ago, 2.4% of the general public has a gambling problem. The immediate response might be, well, gee, that doesn't seem like very much. But when you look at the damage that is done, that problem gamblers cost the state of Alabama $5,000 to $15,000 per person per year for those who are affected. And so, what we know from studying the other state affiliates that have been around for a much longer time, is that the more that we can create in public awareness concerning those who may be at risk, then hopefully we can spare this burden to the Alabama taxpayers. By us getting out into the college campuses, by us being able to go out to churches and civic groups and other organizations and talk about what are the warning signs, talk about what might put you at high risk to become a problem gambler. And problem gambling is it's a family disease. Everybody in the family gets sick. Imagine one day the wife opening up a bank statement and finding out that the savings account has been completely wiped out, and then finding out that the 401k no longer exists, and then reading the credit card statements to find out that the credit cards have been completely maxed out, and then to add insult to injury, the mortgage company calls and says, Mrs. So-and-so, we're really sorry, but now we're going to have to, we've already foreclosed on the house, and we'll be auctioning it off this week. And all of a sudden, here's a wife with five children, and she doesn't know what to do because her husband had a gambling problem. It's a hidden disease with no outward signs. It's a hidden disease with no outward signs. There is no blood test or urine test that's going to make you positive for dice or slot machines. There is no dice in the eyes when you come walking into a room. There is no breathalyzer test that you can take. And problem gamblers, ladies and gentlemen, they are the most creative and manipulative creatures on the face of the planet. They're very secretive about their money. They don't want anyone else to know what's going on with their finances. Because you see, for a problem gambler, money is the drug of choice. If a person's an alcoholic, the drug of choice is alcohol. If a person is a problem gambler, well then their drug of choice is money. And as long as someone will pay, as long as those enablers are out there, as long as someone will pay, the gambler will play. And I'm ashamed that the things that I did during the last year of my misery, not my misery as well, but the fact that, you know, who's not going to believe the pastor? And yet every time I would make up a story and I would get money from people, I'd say, that's okay, this next time that I go to gamble, it's going to be the big win, and all the money's going to come in, and I'll be able to pay off all those people. Well, if you're a problem gambler, you don't know when to say when. Now, if you take a look at this picture here, boy, that's something else. You obviously can look at this picture and say, okay, this particular person is addicted to meth. No doubt about it, okay? There's outward signs. But if you saw this gentleman in the pulpit, you would say, oh, is he a problem gambler? Gee, you know, there's no signs. If I stumbled in one Sunday and I was three sheets to the wind, somebody might say, hey, I think the preacher's got a drinking problem. But I could get up into the pulpit, ladies and gentlemen, and part of the insanity of my addiction at that time was I could quote that famous scripture in Deuteronomy that says, you can be sure your sin will seek you out. And then I would say to myself, oh, that nobody's going to find out about my gambling addiction. No way, no way. This is what a gambling addict looks like. Last night, he's addicted to gambling. Her mode of poison is poker. And Gladys Knight writes in her autobiography that when she takes money and she's paying bills, it's money. But when she's sitting at the poker table, it's just something she can use in order to make that next bet. And Gladys Knight was known to be able to put $45,000 down on a single end of poker. And by the time, and this is what is so dangerous about problem gambling. By the time the problem gambler is found out, then much of the damage has already been done. Now, again, the very first time that I missed a house payment, I should have picked up the phone and said to someone, I need help. I just missed a mortgage payment, and I can't believe that I let that mortgage payment lapse because of that. But you see, because we're gambling addicts, we tell ourselves, that's okay, we can fix this, it's not a problem. I just didn't gamble right the last time. And again, it's that mentality of the next time, the next bet, that's going to win all the money back, and I'm going to be able to pay off all those debts. get that money is the drug of choice for a problem gambler. Ladies and gentlemen, if you know somebody in your circle and you think they've got a gambling problem, the one thing you don't ever want to do for them is loan them money. If they call you and they say they need gas for their car, well, then get them to come pick you up and you ride with them and you go put the gas in the car, all right? Fulfill the need, but don't give them the money, okay? Because again, money is the drug of choice. And again, why can't they just stop? Well, because it's an addiction. And there are so many, you know, even though we do not have gambling legalized here in Alabama as a state, we have a huge problem because gambling is everywhere. There is more sports betting per capita in the state of Alabama than in any other state in the United States. And that's why during this March Madness time, we want to have the conversation. We want to say, if you're gambling money that you can't afford to lose, if you're having to lie to people to cover up your gambling activity, well, then you may just have a problem. And so what should you do if you suspect that someone within your circle is a problem gambler? Well, number one, have the conversation. Have the conversation. Be that channel of change. Sit down with somebody and let them know, I'm really concerned about you. I've been thinking about, you know, your activities here recently, and I'm really concerned that maybe they might have a problem. A lot of people, when they think of problem gambling, they'll say, well, I'm not like those people at the poker table. I'm not like those people who sit at home and gamble. And by the way, in the day and age that we live in now, there's over 2,500 internet sites that a person can get on right in the luxury of their own living room. So isn't that wonderful? Now you can lose your house without ever leaving your house. You know, here's mom, she puts Barney on the television, and she puts the little four-year-old in front of the television set, and then she goes to sit down at her laptop and play online blackjack. And she just keeps swiping that credit card, and keep running up that bet. So as I say, gambling is all around us, and we don't even realize it. If you know someone that you think might have a gambling problem, we have partnered with the United Way's 211 Network as our channel of help. All you have to do is pick up the phone, dial 211, and tell someone, hey, I've got a gambling problem. Where is there the closest therapist that I can see? Where is the closest Gamblers Anonymous meeting? Where is the closest Celebrate Recovery or other support groups where I can go to help? And that will get them the help that they need. In fact, you can even locate me if you call 211 and say, you know, who is in the state that is the person to go to about gambling addiction? And then the last thing you can do is just get involved in the cause to help us help others who might be at risk for developing a gambling problem. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy anytime to come out, as I said, to your church, to another civic meeting, to your place of employment. I'll be glad to come and have the conversation. That's what we're here for. And by the way, I'm in my fifth year, pastor of Cedarwood Community Church in Utica. It's a nice little church. I enjoy it very much. And the day that I pulled into the parking lot and I saw my name on the church sign, I walked up to the pulpit that morning and I said to my congregation, thank you. Thank you for allowing me to see what recovery looks like. At this time,